Comrade Sampath, member of the Central Committee of CPIM, Comrade N. Ram, and we have senior advocates and other friends on the dais here, and my very dear friends from this historic city of India, Chennai. I feel privileged, and in fact at the time of our recently held party congress at Hyderabad, immediately I was asked to come to this place. Despite certain specific environment in Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir, it was a little difficult to secure some time at this juncture, but nevertheless, it was my inner feeling to come here to share my grief and sorrow and whatever with my friends here in Chennai, the city of democratic traditions, the city of tolerant culture, the city of proud history of struggles as well. So really I feel privileged. Though the topic itself and the discussion here this evening saddens all of us. It's not just a story of the past. It's not just some politician's gimmick as a usual routine in today's world. It is really what is happening in Kashmir. That beautiful small piece of land with some people. They were born with some hopes, with some aspirations, with some demands. That is burning. That continues to burn. Not only that is burning, I will add one more thing. My Kashmir and your Kashmir and the Kashmir of the people of that unfortunate land, that is bleeding as well. Why it is happening now? Why all this is happening now? Is it inevitable to happen? Could it have been avoided? Who is responsible for this unfortunate situation? The people of Kashmir? Pakistan's bad intentions? Or somewhere else? Some people who refuse to learn from the experiences of history. Those at the helm of affairs who refuse to recognize the necessity of preserving, protecting the interests of the people. If you go to the history, it will take much longer time to explain the causes behind the present turmoil, the present unrest. But one thing I must tell you, and through you, the people of Tamil Nadu, that that is the people of Kashmir, at the other end of the country, when partition took place, when Pakistan emerged as an independent country, when the country got divided into two countries, when Punjab was bleeding, thousands got massacred. Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs were butchered. When the rest of the subcontinent got food registered, and even part of Jammu and Kashmir called Jammu, there were colonial clash, there was lot of bloodshed. It was that valley of Kashmir, where not a single communal incident took place in those hard times. Not a single incident. I just want to remind those who are trying to deface Kashmir . Those who want to distort history of our country, including Kashmir, just look what Gandhi said at the time of those hard days, that it is Kashmir where from there is some ray of hope emerging for the rest of the country. It is at that point of time when there was a choice, a place, Muslim-dominated area, bordering with Pakistan, according to the partition plan, was having a choice, either to be with this part of the country or that part of the divide, or remain independent. Rejecting two-nation theory, rejecting the pleas, rejecting appeals on the name of religion, telling the world, telling their brethren elsewhere that we the Muslims of Kashmir don't want to see the world divided on the basis of religion. We don't want to see this world is one for all of us to live with each other. Send a strong message by rejecting two-nation theory and opting for some sort of a relationship with secular India. This is Kashmir, and this is the Kashmir's journey for the relationship with this country. During the freedom struggle, when there was Quit India movement being conducted here, and Quit Kashmir movement in Kashmir, there emerged some sort of a common ground. Please try to understand it. The relationship is not just created for a scheme, it emerged out of a prolonged struggle for certain common ideals, certain common destination. That common destination and that common ground was based on mutual respect, pluralism, and making this society a livable one, irrespective of one's faith, irrespective of one's caste, creed, or any affiliation. That was the basis of relationship. This was India then, and this was Kashmir then. They joined together. Please try to remember, at the time when raiders came, Maharaja asked for armed intervention from Delhi. It came a little later. It was a Kashmiri Muslim. The people of Kashmir who resisted the raiders, not out of certain compulsions, not at all. It was out of conviction that religion cannot be the basis of discord. Religion cannot be a tool to divide the people. Please try to understand the message of the people of Kashmir then. And I say to all, that message is not only relevant for Kashmir in today's charged circumstances, but that message is equally important for the rest of both India and Pakistan as well. That's how Bapu said that I wish it to envision the future of India through the prism of Kashmir. Another event of the history that the then Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir, Shri Hari Singh, he was reluctant to accede to India for quite some time. It's not me. These are the hard facts of history. And whatever is happening today around, it's not only today. If there was some divisive tendency emerging from the Muslim community, there was more ferociously emerging another variety of this communal brand of politics, and that surfaced in Jammu in the name of Parda Parishad, the then BJP or Bhartiya Jansan, called Parja Parish. It's not today. I am again repeating. Such forces have been working even those days. Since those days, to disrupt this relation, emerging relationship with the Union, under one party or the other. And it was in those circumstances that the Constituent Assembly, after a thorough debate, provided certain guarantee to this unique relationship between Union and the people of Jammu and Kashmir. It was under those special circumstances, unique circumstances, and that's why the facts of history confirm that when the rest of the country, when the rest of the people merged with the Indian Union, it was Jammu and Kashmir which acceded to the Union of India. We have to differentiate between the two. That's why separate constitution, apart from the constitution of India, a separate constitution for Jammu and Kashmir, a separate constituent assembly for Jammu and Kashmir emerged. Article 370, much noise has been created throughout the length and breadth of the country for the last so many decades. This has emerged out of a longer debate and discussion in the Constituent Assembly between the leadership of the country and the leadership of Jammu and Kashmir. And it is this article through which the Constitution of India has become operative. It is through this constitutional provision that accession got certified. Thus, unfortunately, this relationship, this opportunity for cementing this relationship was not availed. What happened sooner, right from 1953, the same instrument, the tallest of all whole team of the leadership there in Jammu and Kashmir, Sheikh Abdullah, he was arrested. And the process of broken promises, breaking promises starts. The process of dismantling, I must use this word, process of dismantling the very foundations of that relationship between Union and Kashmir started. That was the beginning of not cementing the relationship, but virtually dismantling the relationship. We are having a proud leader here from Tamil Nadu, Comrade P. Ramamurthy. He was meeting Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah in jail here as well. He has told us many things about what went wrong and how went wrong. But please, I can understand. The same article of faith, the constitutional guarantees, by now 43 amendments have been virtually enforced. 43 amendments in the constitution eroding the very basis of Article 370. Who did it? And the simple question from us is, the simple question should be, with what aim? What did the leadership achieve by eroding whatever little autonomy was provided to the people of Kashmir? Not only that, it's again using the authority arbitrarily, imposing Article 249 of the Constitution of India, thereby, that's not applicable to other parts of the country in such a manner as it is being used in Jammu and Kashmir. Parliament can make laws now, just by a resolution of the Rajya Sabha about the matters which fall in the state list. You cannot imagine what kind of autonomy was promised to the people of Jammu and Kashmir and what kind of erosion has taken place since then. As of now, the fact remains Kashmir is having less than what other states of the country are involved. And in this process of broken promises, the other aspect was covered, that is denial of democracy to the people of Kashmir, with the rest of India was involved. Falsification of elections, fraudulent elections, imposing governments from Union itself, organizing defections, virtually imposing puppet regimes in the state, that has been a long history in Jammu and Kashmir. I must pose a question to the people, great people of Tamil Nadu, if such a treatment is God save you, God save us all. I don't know whether he has some sort of a capacity to save us or not, but certainly that will be horrible. Because of all these processes, what happened in Kashmir, now all of us have to witness and all of us have to bear the brunt of whatever has been done by the regimes, particularly the regime now in authority. Now today is something more than whatever was happening in Islam. Under the garb of Hindu creating, building up Hindu Rashtra. Now tell me, very frankly, I must put it before you. We have joined secular India in aspiration for the people of Kashmir was to join the brethren of the rest of the subcontinent here in India to enjoy the fruits of democracy, to enjoy the fruits of modern life, development. And that can be possible under a system where there are genuine, strong foundations for living together, secular foundations. Now, one strong tendencies like demolition of mosques, when the question of imposing restrictions on your behavior, your day-to-day life, what to eat, what not to eat, how to live, how not to live, when such a conduct is being, it's not by some rowdies, some gunda elements, some groups. But when the state is under the shadow of such forces encouraging such tendencies, and minorities, Dalits are being hunted, weaker sections are being ill-treated, religion as a political tool for polarization is being encouraged. Please tell me how it will impact the minds of the democratic sections of our society, the minorities, the weaker sections, and particularly that area of Kashmir, which has stood like a rock against that appeal on the basis of religion, two-nation theory, and opted for relationship with secular India. How it will impact the minds and hearts of those people here? Just for a while, please consider. Friends, people of Kashmir, they are not born with the Kalashnikov in their hands. It's not a choice for them. It has never been. For a Kashmiri young person picking up the stone, it's not like he's not enjoying it. Almost on a routine funerals, it is not a chance for an average sister and mother of a Kashmiri. It is not. They have certain aspirations, they have aspired for, they have opted for a good life, a seeker life, a dignified life. Ask those at the helm of affairs, have you anything in your mind to offer to the people of Kashmir? There is only one response. I don't want to repeat the incidents, the history that is so unfortunate, that is so painful. I don't want to repeat it. But I have a question as a citizen to the present dispensation, claiming to be hyper-nationalist patriots. Do you have anything to offer to your own citizens in Kashmir except bullets, pellets, except injuries, deaths and destruction? Have you anything? My friends, there is a question now. This is being posed before the people of the country and with a purpose. The purpose is use Kashmir for polarizing the situation in the rest of the country. Use Kashmir's tragedy for dividing the ranks of the people of the rest of India to get more votes. And I am here to appeal to you, to the people of Tamil Nadu. Please try to understand the pain and agony with the people, your brethren in other part of the country in Kashmir are facing today. They are crying for help. They are crying for that somebody should come forward and own our misery, own our painful story. There is none. I am talking from the authority. Only message is that Kashmir has turned violent. We are killing terrorists. We are killing militants. Where from these militants have come from? Who has created such a situation where our youngsters are becoming, getting into the trap of violence? Why is it that there have been time and again announcements made that now militancy is over, peace has been restored? In the recent past, different functionaries in the government have announced that we have killed this much, now it is over. We have taught them a lesson. We have taught the lesson of their masters in Pakistan. How it is emerging, surfacing again and again? One must question, one must ask this painful question and seek answers, not for doing any favor to the people of Kashmir, but more so doing favor for this great, the unity of this great country, for the welfare of the people of India. I am not here, certainly not asking a favor, not at all. I am here as a proud citizen, just informing my brothers and sisters in the rest of the country what exactly is happening in Kashmir by those who claim to be, who claim to be protectors of the interests of the people of India. My very dear friends, before this regime came into place here, BJP led government, in 2014 elections were held for parliamentary elections as in the rest of the country. People of Kashmir participated in good numbers. Again, in the same year 2014, assembly elections were held. Participation was quite enthusiastic. Younger generation, they participated in the electoral process. What went wrong since then? I just want to remind that in 2014, BJP argued for, campaigned for getting elected on the basis of, apart from other issues, one slogan that we have faced floods, people of Kashmir, and we have survived. Now there is a big political flood coming in the shape of BJP. This is what BJP campaigned in Kashmir. Characterized BJP's manifesto and campaigning as a big political flood. It has to be registered for the survival of the people of Kashmir, and it can be registered only by PDP, vote for PDP. And here in Jammu, BJP campaigned plus 44, gave us 44 seats. We will save Jammu from the clutches of Kashmiris. We will free you from the clutches of the Kashmiri leadership. We will restore the old glory of Goa. My point is, you see, what BJP said in Jammu, what BJP said in Kashmir, poles apart, but after the elections, saying Mantushudi to Manshudan, getting integrated to each other. And a new combination emerged in Jammu and Kashmir on principle, no common ground of principles, agendas, but just to share the power, just because of lust of her power. Yeah, otherwise, one cannot understand how the same people 2014 voting enthusiastically, taking part in electoral process, then in 2016 only coming on the streets, the whole population almost with stones in their hands. What happened there? Even now, two parliamentary seats got vacant. Midterm poll was announced last year. Farooq Abdullah got elected from Srinagar seat with 7% votes only. Poll. Only 7%. And south of Kashmir, which is epicenter for today's unrest, seat of PDP, Nadu was elected as member of parliament. Midterm poll was announced in the process itself. The collection commission was asked to postpone it till now. Elections are not, they can't dare to hold elections there in South Kashmir. Answer this question, what went wrong? Who is responsible? It is cross-border terrorism, as Modi says. And then they are claiming that we have, because of surgical strikes, we have beaten them enough. They can't dare to do it now again. Then they are telling the country that it is the unrest is, stones are being thrown on the security forces because of Pakistan is giving them money. Terrorist funding is there, and because of demonetization, we have stopped all the channels now. This has been announced. Now again, we are saying, as of now, 2018, there is no end to the cycles of violence, cycles of unrest, and the support base of this cycle of violence is getting broadened day by day. They are hoodwinking the people of India, the rest of India, by telling us that situation is under control. It is not. There are certain places where recently encounters have taken place, and the young people, young generation, coming in thousands, not in hundreds, coming in thousands and storming the sites of encounters, defying the death. Tell me, who has created this horrible situation? Who is responsible? I am here today to, through you, appeal the people of Tamil Nadu, appeal the people of India, make this government accountable. They are destroying the foundations of our unity. They are demolishing whatever relationship we were having with each other. Before it is too late, pick up the threads. Pick up the threads. Join together, resist this politics of division, politics of hate. People of Kashmir, you have this realization that violence cannot provide solution to their problems. They do realize that violence is not an option. And I appeal to the rest of our younger generation in other parts of the country is, like you, they want to have good education, good opportunities for life. But somebody must come forward to own their pain and agony, share that pain. Governments have failed, the present dispensation has disastrously failed. Rather, it is provoking them. I appeal to you, the younger generation of the country, to come forward, and your brother in Kashmir, they expect you to share their pain and agony. Come forward and adopt them, share their pain, and we can show to the world what governments cannot do, people can do it. I appeal to the people of this country, the democratic forces, the tolerant people, the righteous, the intellectuals to rise up before it is too late, save Kashmir from the drift. Country is losing Kashmir. Save Kashmir, save country from this disaster. You can do it only by demanding from the government to stop this brutal repression in Kashmir. Stop it. Stop blinding the younger generation here to telephones. Stop it. Stop indiscriminate use of force against its own population. Initiate a credible, structured process of dialogue with all stakeholders. Initiate dialogue with Pakistan. You have fought wars. Pakistan has not acted honorably at different times. Nevertheless, the option is dialogue, like after so many decades of hostility, only yesterday a good news has come. South and North are talking together. I'm talking of South Korea and North Korea talking together. When they can talk together, why can't we talk together to resolve our issue? My friends, I was just trying to avoid this. Another painful chapter has been added to our history, unfortunate history. Quite recently, one of our HIL has been butchered, all of you know. A child has been kidnapped, a child has been raped, gang-raped, a child has been butchered. A child has not been allowed to be buried in her native place just because that child who does not know who she was, who she is, what religion means for her, she was just punished for that. Shocking, devastating. But more shocking is the silence of those in authority. The shocking incident took place in the month of January. And our Prime Minister opens up the mouth in April. No word. No time to express concern about that. That poor child. Is this India of my dreams, your dreams? Is this the future of my children? Who is that child? Whose child he is, she is? I was just reminding you, my young stars, own the pain of the young stars in Kashmir. I appeal to the people of the country share the pain, share the pain of this child. Are you still looking through the prism of religion? What this, what the religion she was, what caste she belonged to, are these the questions to be asked about such a brutal act? Can you imagine in today's world, in a particular area, the political representatives, those in authority in those areas in the government, they are reluctant to share the grief of that family. They are reluctant to visit those unfortunate parents of that child. Can you imagine? Just for what? Who is promoting mistrust? Who is promoting the space for violence? Who is promoting the animation? These are the questions which are involved. It is not an isolated incident. It is an unfortunate, extremely shocking. It has shaken us. But there's a background. Those Gujars and Bakarwals, they belong to one community. They are settled here in Kotwa area. Just to evict them from their land and property. This most condemnable act was organized and initiated. Even though I wonder, it's not the question of what certain vested interest, certain bad elements in that particular area did. More shocking is, those leaders who are at the helm of affairs, ministers in the government, trying to obstruct the process of investigation, not ordinary people. They are organizing under the banner of Hindu Ekta Manch, using religion as a tool, not to side with the victim, not to seek justice for the victim, but to provide excuses for protecting the accused. And they're not the same people who are part of the government here. They're not testing the very instruments which are working under their guidance, the Jammu Kashmir police, who are being hailed, praised for their courageous struggle against violence, militancy. They are not being tested for an investigation now. Now the demand is CPIM must come forward, not Jammu and Kashmir police. How unfortunate. A few persons from the bar, they are obstructing, who are part of the justice system. They are preventing police from filing the challenge.
charge sheet in the court. And Supreme Court directs Bar Council of India to constitute a committee and investigate. And Bar Council of India, that committee is not asking anything, they are asking a CBI probe, which was not, they were not asked to suggest which agency should probe and which agency should not probe. My simple question is, on whose side you stand by? For the victim or for those who are alleged to be involved in that heinous crime? If you ask me, the source of today's crisis in Kashmir is mistrust, distrust, and the challenging task before the nation, before the country is how best we can take confidence building measures, corrective measures, take initiatives which can help us in reaching to the people of Kashmir. That is the only path which can lead us to some better alternatives, better solutions for overcoming the crisis. But on the other hand, such like the Kothua incident being used as a tool for political divide, using as a tool for political polarization is, to say the least, shameful. It is shameful. It is, I think, I have no words to express my concern about whatever is happening regarding this incident. The same community of people, Gujar and Bakarwal, known for their patriotism, known for their sanity, what kind of message is going there? What kind of trust you are building within their ranks? That's why I am here today this evening to appeal, because I have no hope about the present dispensation, the present leadership of the country. They want votes, they want elections, they want division, they want polarization, they want destroy. Whatever sanity is left now, stand up, my brothers and sisters, wherever you are. Save Kashmir, save India. Save the future of this great country that can be, that we shall do that by uniting together, resisting the onslaught of these disastrous policies pursued by BJP government as of now. But I must leave now with a message that for the people of Kashmir, that we are not alone. You know, friends and supporters elsewhere. Maybe those in authority have done many wrongs, but there are people of India who still have concern about the future of the people of Kashmir. And I assure you, for the people of Kashmir, the rest of the country, that we still have, we will continue to have hope about a better future together. Together. We will fight together, we will shape our future together. My only appeal this evening is, whatever our political, ideological differences, whatever our caste and creed, my only appeal is, that today is the time that we should stand up and say that no more hate, no more politics of hate that divide is required for this great country. Stop it and stop it now.